Hi, it's Donnie Brisky from Real Ghost Stories Online. Every single day, Jenny and myself do our best to try and create the best possible show for you. But it's not free to do that. We have a lot of hard costs on this end to distribute the show, produce the show, and put it out there for you. So we ask for your help by becoming an EPP, an extra podcast person. We're doing our best to make it worth your while by giving you a bonus episode every single week with some of the best stories we can find. Also, exclusive video content, including our new monthly video feature, Seeing Ghosts, where we examine some of the best ghost photos and discuss them that we get into the show here at Real Ghost Stories Online. All I ask is that if you listen to the show on a regular basis, please consider helping support keeping it on the air. It's only $5 a month, or sign up for a full year at a time and get 1 month free. If you already are an EPP, thank you very much. If you're not yet, please consider supporting a show that you enjoy so we can continue creating it for you. Sign up at realghoststoriesonline.com, click become an EPP, and thank you.
Welcome to Real Ghost Stories Online. Call in your real ghost story now at 855-853-4802 or write in at realghoststoriesonline.com. You are about to enter the world of the unknown and quite possibly the undead. This is Real Ghost Stories Online.
And on today's episode of Real Ghost Stories Online, passersby find they have grown used to seeing an old woman as they go by, only that woman hasn't been there for days. A man boards a bus only to never get off at his stop. A man is compelled to turn the messages he receives at night into a book, only there are some dire consequences to that decision. And could pregnancy have a role and the empathic activity one listener experiences? Those stories, your calls, and more today on Real Ghost Stories Online. Tony and Jenny Brusky joining you once again.
Hello.
Hi, and how are you this fine day?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm glad I'm not visiting Euro Disney or Disney Paris anytime soon, because I don't think you're going to be getting on the haunted house ride anytime. Well, I'll probably get that wrapped up fairly soon. I don't know if you heard. And it's not to make light of it. I just some listeners had sent it to us. And I mean, it's a sad circumstance. An employee there of the park was working in the haunted manor. It's called Phantom Manor at Disneyland Paris. And he was electrocuted when he was working on some part of the ride that needed some fixing. And they found him later. Luckily, he was, from what I understand in the news story, was found by staff, not like children going through the ride going, yeah, my, that looks mighty real. Mm-hmm. So that's that. I don't know if the ride is closed down as of the time of this recording, but I'm sure they'll get that probably up. And it wasn't like it was, I don't believe, super gruesome or destroying the ride or anything like that.
Yeah.
But it's one of those things where down the road now, it's going to make me wonder if we're going to get stories of a haunted ride. Like we get stories of the haunted ride at Disney World, mm-hmm, of the Pirates of the Caribbean, where there's a story, and it's a true story of a man who was also a maintenance worker there years ago, died while maintaining the ride.
Right. And right now they say if the staff does not say, you know, good morning to George, or, mm-hmm, you know, thank George for a good day at the end.
Sure.
That it causes problems with the ride. And I thought about that when last time we were there,
mm-hmm,
because
it was down all the time.
It was down a lot.
Yeah.
So kind of wondered if somebody sloughed off thanking George.
You know, it's an interesting thing. I wonder how often it is where you get the new, you know, employees that come to the park, and then the story is told and they're like, yeah, whatever. And they just kind of ignore it. And then it's kind of a learning by experience type deal where, mm-hmm, well, it does break down quite a bit when I don't do it. Maybe I should start trying. And then suddenly it just, you know.
What does it hurt?
Exactly. What does it hurt? So, I don't know. Interesting. It makes me also wonder about, would this be a news story if it had happened on a different ride other than the Haunted Mansion, you know, being what it is, and it being, you know, it makes me wonder how often do things like this happen at parks like that,
mm-hmm,
you know, because there's there's so many moving parts, for lack of a better term.
Sure.
And a lot of electricity and a lot of this and a lot of that. How often, you know, are there tragedies that are kind of, you know, swept under the rug and mm-hmm. not necessarily, not like they pretend they don't happen. They just kind of keep them quiet and take care of the families and, you know,
right.
and try not to make a big deal out of it for lack, you know, not wanting to have a big news story. But anyway, when I first saw the story, I had to like look it up a couple places to make sure it wasn't some sort of bizarro, not real news sure. story, because we get those sometimes. But no, it's, I've looked at several places and it appears to be, legit. So, not a good situation. So there you go. Interesting mm-hmm. stuff. We'll see in 5 years if we start getting ghost stories from that park. I was also curious about the ride.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, how much is it like the other ones? Fairly similar.
Is it like Disneyland's Haunted Mansion or Disney World's?
Never been to the Disneyland one, but it seems to have a lot of aspects of the Disney World one.
What does it look like on the outside?
It looks more like the Disneyland one.
Okay.
On the outside. But the interior seems a lot fairly similar to the world.
Mm-hmm.
So is the land the same as the world as far as how the ride goes?
They're very, very similar.
Not identical, but similar?
Yeah. Okay. It's just the outside looks totally different.
Yeah. Okay. I was just wondering how much they duplicated
mm-hmm.
from park to park. Anyhow. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online to share your real ghost stories with us. Of course, you can also write it on our website, realghoststoriesonline.com, or if you'd like to record your story on your mobile device. I like that one better.
Mobile
device. you can do that, and you can email us that audio then. Tony at realghoststoriesonline.com is the place to send that audio from your mobile devices. Our first story, dear Tony and Jenny, I have many stories to tell, but this is a short one for you, and I hope you'll enjoy. In the year 2003, after my best friend was murdered, my sister, my mother, and I decided to leave California. We were tired of the gang violence that had taken my best friend from me, and this event changed us. I believe it opened my third eye as I was there when he was murdered, and so I came close to death that night. We decided to move to Mexico as there was an old abandoned family home, and we wanted to go there temporarily until we got over the shock and depression. We ended up staying there for 8 years, and I married a local woman, and we now have a beautiful 6-year-old girl who is very naturally gifted. More on that some other day. I believe my mother has always been sensitive, but after we moved to Mexico, we all became so sensitive that it caused us a bit of trouble sometimes. One night, my mom was heading home from our sister's house, which was a short 3-minute walk from the house, and we were staying in, and as she got close to the house, she saw a little old lady sitting next to a rubber tree that is outside on the corner of the street of our house. This is a tree that is close to 100 years old. An uncle of mine planted it when he was a young man, and he was about 90 when he passed away about 10 years ago. Anyway, my mother knew a lady that lived down our street, a very skinny old lady that resembles the classic witch, and many people say that she is in fact a witch and does ritual work at night. She's a sweet old lady and related to us distantly that she lives with her son who is in his 50s. He's a trucker, and this is a dangerous job in Mexico due to the drug dealers frequently robbing large trucks either for their contents or simply to instill fear in the locals and flex their authority. The lady sits at the rubber tree most nights to wait for her son to arrive and to be sure he's safe. This night, when my mom saw her, she didn't think anything of it and said, "Buenas noches," as is a custom and polite thing to say as you pass by someone in a small town or village. She didn't receive a response. The lady just sat there in the darkness next to the rubber tree. My mom repeated louder this time, "Buenas noches," and still no response. My mom is well known for not taking anyone's crap and won't stand for someone she's friends with to ignore her and refuse a greeting. She walked over to her and got about 2 feet from the old lady's face to make sure the lady saw her. As she leaned in, she expected to see the woman's features clearly, but she didn't. She was completely black and featureless. At this point, my mom felt a little apprehensive but unsure of what she was seeing, so she walked away and came home. I should say she was not alone. A cousin of hers that she had never met until that day was with her, and she saw what happened and said to her, "Ignore her if she's going to be that way," and he went home as well. The next day, my mom saw the old lady in the morning, and went to her and said, "Didn't you hear me saying good night to you last night?" The old lady was confused. She said, "I haven't seen you in a couple days." My mom said she felt her blood pressure drop a little and found her cousin later that day still visiting. She told him what happened, and right away he said, "Oh shit, it was a ghost." She shrugged it off, refusing to believe it, but he insisted on investigating. Throughout the day, they went around asking people if anyone had ever heard of an old lady appearing there at the tree at night, and most folks will tell you, yes, she's there sometimes when it's dark and the moon is the only light outside. Waiting, facing the street, I have many more stories. From family and from myself especially. I've been practicing magic, not exactly witchcraft, it's a bit more formal, and specifically I work with demons and deities. I started these practices after I arrived in Mexico, and as a direct consequence of my friend's murder. More on this another day. Anonymous from Texas.
I think it's funny that the person who heard the story believed it was a ghost before she actually did, the one that experienced it.
Well, when you go over there and you look at the person and they have no features, it's just this dark hole.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that sign number one that there may be a ghost going on here or something not so normal?
So they just essentially saw a shadow person and she just assumed it was the same lady that's usually in that spot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I think.
That's kind of what I got from it.
I couldn't tell if it was a shadow person or if it was like a fully clothed person and there was like just no features there. I think that would be more of the dead giveaway. Maybe it was more like you're describing.
Okay.
And that's why I'm kind of confused. Like, how the hell did you not know what you were, you know, looking at? Maybe it is more of that nature where from a distance it looks like there's a person there and you get there and it's just kind of this dark thing. I think that makes more sense.
Yeah.
More logical sense as to why the person would be confused and leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, there you go.
There you go.
Not so crazy after all. There you go. 855-853-4802 is our phone number at Real Ghost Stories Online. And as we always say, if you like this show, unfortunately, it does not run on good vibes. As much as good vibes would run the show, it costs money. That's why we ask for your support in keeping it on the air by becoming an EPP. It's only $5 a month. You sign up to be one on our website, realghoststoriesonline.com. Click Become an EPP. We try and make it as affordable as possible. $5 a month. It keeps all the free episodes going, gets you the bonus episodes every single week, and all the bonus video content as well, and all the other extras that we give our EPPs. I just the other day updated the EPP site with some of the back episodes because iTunes only goes so far.
Sure.
As far as how many episodes they show. And it's not us, like, restricting how many episodes. Some shows do that. Some shows are like, you only get 10 episodes and the rest. No, we leave them all up there as long as iTunes will leave them there.
Mm-hmm.
But, and it's really a numbers thing. I believe it goes to, like, $2.99 or something.
We just have too many episodes.
There's just too many damn episodes.
Yeah.
So, in order to still enjoy those fine episodes, like about Amityville Horror and Conjuring and many others, the true stories behind them, the EPPs get those as well. So the ones that drop off, I put onto the EPP site so you can enjoy them there too. So really, I mean, there's the 80-some EPP episodes that are up there, but there's got to be damn near 100 other episodes too of the older regular episodes that are now up there. So there's a lot.
Yeah.
It's a lot of listening, if you will, for only $5 a month. So check that out. Junior writes in, "Good evening, Mr. and Mrs. Brewski. I recently listened to an episode of yours where Mr. Brewski, I never get called that, was asking for stories about haunted vehicles. Hearing that triggered a stored memory of mine about a haunted city bus. This incident occurred in 2012 in Southern California. I was a late night driver through a bad part of town and had just finished dropping off the last passenger, or so I thought. I'm pretty meticulous about paying attention as how many people aboard the bus, but something felt off. I didn't feel alone. All of a sudden, a shiver ran through my body, and all my hairs stood on end. At first, I didn't think much of it, just figured a window was left open and a gust of cold wind swept through the bus. But it was summertime in Southern California. I checked my passenger mirror directly above the driver to check on the passengers, and not a soul in sight. There's a big black box behind the driver that holds all the vehicle's computer systems, and it prevents me to look over my shoulder and check. I then proceeded to look to my right. All night, all the windows act as a mirror inside the bus, eliminating blind spots. And that's when I saw him. an older gentleman sitting directly behind me in the black box. I found it strange that I'd failed to see him before. Just figured I'd made a mistake on my count, that's all. I tried making small talk about the weather or sports, but I got no response. I then asked him for at least a destination so I wouldn't pass his bus stop. But still, there was no response. He sat motionless, just looking out the window, not even acknowledging me. At that point, what could I do but continue en route and wait for him to pull the cord? A few blocks before final stop and complete deboarding of passengers, I heard him say, "Here comes my stop." And I replied, "Please hold on, sir, until I come to a full stop," which I did. I lowered the bus suspension so it wouldn't be that high of a step for him and opened the doors, but he never came. I set my parking brake to immediately check to see if he fell or something worse, but he was nowhere to be found. Not on the bus. Not near or around the bus. There was no sign he was even there. Shaken, I called my dispatch, thinking in the back of my mind that I was probably going to be laughed at, but no. All I got was, "Are you driving bus number 2613 en route to such and such?" I replied a hesitated yes. Then I asked, "How did you know and why?" I got no direct response, just, "Return to base if empty, please," and a faint laugh on the other end. The next day, I spoke with a supervisor who let me in on the joke. The bus I was driving had accidentally killed two different people, years apart, at almost the exact same location. The location where my passenger disappeared. P.S. I've been interested in the paranormal since my earliest memory, which happens to be the reason why I search for it. I have more stories to write about. I don't want to sound cliche and say, "If you want, I can write them in." I'll just write them in. I'll start off with the headless, bleeding doll that started my interest in the paranormal. Have a great night.
Have a great night. Headless, bleeding doll.
It's a nice way to end a letter. I'm going to end all letters that way. Christmas cards and the like. Happy holidays from the Brewskis. Hope you have a headless, bleeding doll arrive underneath your Christmas tree this year. Have a great night. Yep. There you go.
I think it's really interesting that, you know, they already knew what he was going to be talking about as far as the ghost.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they knew what bus and where and everything. Makes you wonder how many times they have seen or had somebody have seen something there or had a phantom passenger.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes you wonder too, okay, is it just this bus? Is it this bus stop, which is haunted?
Mm-hmm. And is it residual? Is it residual as well? Because there is no interaction.
Yeah.
I mean, he did ask, you know, said, "This is my stop," but he didn't respond to anything. Mm-hmm. That's where he makes you, you know, as a part of it was, I'd also like to know, you know, it said the bus killed two people. Were these people that were actually riding the bus? Were these people that were outside of the bus,
mm-hmm,
and that got hit? Or what, you know, what exactly occurred there?
Yeah.
And what did they look like? Because that could be another tell, you know, oh, and it happens to look just like the person that was killed by the bus.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it could be some interesting pieces to that whole puzzle there. Good story. 855-853-4802 is our phone number. Hello, Brewskis. Our next letter begins. Stephen in Belgrade here. Maybe I said Bozeman before. I don't remember. Belgrade, just outside of Bozeman. Is that Montana? Bozeman, Montana?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
I'm not sure. Anyway, it's been a while. In my last letter, I teased a story of disembodied voices, specifically two voices. Both have only ever said one word, Stephen. I'll start with a female voice. I don't remember the first time I heard her. And at first, I didn't recognize her as a specific voice. I just know that I frequently heard a woman call my name almost singingly. She drops her voice a half step at a second syllable, but either no one was there or no one would admit to calling me. And I was so young that it was easy for adults to just write it off. I had a bunch of friends over for my 16th birthday. Lots of food, badminton, and some horror movies for once it got dark. We ended up watching VeggieTales instead. We moved out to the front yard. His parents arrived to pick people up. We were standing in a circle in the dark when I hear a voice, "Steven." I turned my head to the direction of the sound, and so did the rest of the group.
Okay, you can't do it singy-song like that. You gotta do it creepy. Steven.
Oh, okay. But didn't he say singy-songy-ish, kind of?
I don't think so.
Steven.
There you go.
Okay.
That's what the show's about.
The only time you're asking me to be more creepy.
Yep.
That's interesting.
It's a first.
There we go. I turned my head in the direction of the sound, and so did the rest of the group. There were at least 8 of us there, and we all heard her. We walked up and down the block looking for the source of the voice, but no one was there. This is the first time that others acknowledged hearing her. I still hear her, and now I'll feel comfortable, hand pressed against my back along with the voice. This started shortly after I moved away from home. I've never been scared by her. There was one time I was home alone, doors locked, and in the shower, and I heard her. Steven.
There you go.
My shower was over at that point. The other voice was not so friendly. He started calling to me in the same way as the first voice did, except he never sang it. He was non-threatening, and I didn't even recognize it as a distinct voice at first, just someone calling for me. But when I tried to find out what that someone had wanted, nobody would admit to calling me. The male voice didn't start until I was about 17, and he only stayed around for 2 years. At least I hope he's left after 2 years. It's been 7 years since I've heard him. I had a moment with the male voice where someone else heard him as well. I was driving around town with a friend when he called my name. She looked behind her as the rear seat and to the rear seat and could not find the source of the voice. I started to feel this heavy darkness over me shortly after this incident. The darkness continued to grow and started affecting my mood. As I'm writing this, I realized the female voice became less frequent when he started calling to me, and by the time that I felt the darkness, she was gone. I'll come back to this thought because I'm realizing that these two voices are more connected than I had realized. It was Halloween night 2009. I hadn't done anything for Halloween other than watch ghost shows on Travel Channel. I went to my room, shut off the lights, and crawled into bed, and he was there. No physical manifestation, no calling of my name, but his darkness was tangible. He stood in front of my bedroom door, watching me. I was terrified. I wanted to run, to scream, to fight him, but I couldn't. So I began to pray. I grabbed my phone from my nightstand and called the same friend that had been in the car with me. I told her what was happening, and she prayed with me. We prayed for hours, and finally I fell asleep. When I woke up, he was gone. I haven't heard him or felt that type of darkness ever since. The shower incident with the female voice happened a short time later, and I don't remember exactly, but it was within the next 2 weeks. Thank you for your hard work putting on the show and for helping people come to terms with their unexplained experiences. Sometimes just telling the story connects the dots. It certainly did for me. This is the last story from my personal experiences for now, at least until I have a new encounter. Again, thank you and good night. Steven in Belgrade.
I really think of all the things a ghost can say to you, One of the scariest things is your own name.
Why is that?
Well, for one, it catches your attention, unlike something else.
Mm-hmm.
And then two, if there's nobody else there that could have said it, it's just that much scarier. I don't know why.
I think it's because it's showing a level of intelligence that's not just to the area. It's referencing, the den. Den's not that scary. The basement. Or referencing something of physicality that may have been there when they were there.
Mm-hmm.
And they're just talking about that. It's showing that they are there and they know you are there too. And what else do they know?
Right.
And what else can they do? That's the question. So there you go. Good story. Thank you for sharing that, Stephen in Belgrade. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online to share your stories with us. Joseph writes in, I've got a few stories, but the first one I'll tell you guys is one that happened to my little brother, most of which include him, but this one wasn't directly including me. He must have been around 4 or 5 years old, so this was between 13 to 14 years ago. My mom's friend's ex-husband died, and they were getting back to her house from the memorial service. The house isn't too big, so if someone was talking loud enough, you can hear it from most places in the house, and my little brother still has a volume problem. My mom and her friend were sitting in the kitchen smoking and sent my little brother upstairs to her bedroom to play. They thought they heard talking from the upstairs, even though he's alone, so they stopped talking to try to listen. They heard him say, "My name is Brian. What's your name?" He was having what sounded like a normal conversation, completely by himself. They go upstairs to see what's going on and ask him who he's talking to, and he says her late ex-husband's name. My little brother did not know him and did not go to the memorial service, and started to describe how he looked. He then pointed at the gap between the ceiling and the full-length mirror and said, "He's right there." They promptly scooped him up and went to the nearby McDonald's until my dad was able to meet him. I'm a new listener currently catching up on Spotify and soon to be an EPP. You'll get more from me soon. Great show. And thanks for listening. I mean,
thanks for letting me share.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that's what we say, mm-hmm. isn't it? Thanks for listening. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But too, thanks for...
Oh, thanks for listening to them.
Yeah.
Oh, like Dr. Fraser Crane. I'm listening.
There you go.
You're welcome. I get it. Took me a moment because I'm slow.
I wonder if that was the only instance of that particular person showing up. If it was just because they were so newly dead, they hadn't gone into the light yet, or if they continued to stick around and follow people around.
If they were fresh dead?
Well, yeah, I guess so.
I don't know. It's an interesting one. Did it? I don't know. Don't recall. Did it give a date on the death? It sounded like it was a while before.
I thought they said they'd just gone to the funeral.
Okay. So they had gone to the memorial. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So that would imply, I get it. Okay. That could be. I mean, that seems to be a very common thing where there's a lot of dead that come back right after death.
Mm-hmm.
And then they move on. So sometimes when people start seeing a ghost, I think sometimes the assumption is, oh, they're a ghost. They're going to always be here. Not always the case.
No.
Sometimes it's just they're making their rounds, just visiting. And maybe they were just visiting there.
Or sometimes they just come back, and yeah. then they go back.
And then sometimes they come back even after that to visit.
Mm-hmm.
At least that we had a guest on the other day that was talking about that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
about just kind of making their visits, just as in real life. You go and visit your loved ones and your relatives, and sometimes that could be happening there too.
Yeah.
Not always lurking around the house,
sure.
if you will. So, good story. Thanks for sharing. Next story, let me first say I love your show. My father passed away 9 years ago due to suicide. Bipolar got the best of him, but if he were alive today, he would love your show as well. I know he would have shared his story, which is what I will do today. When I was 3 or so, my father was hurt on a job, broke a disc or two in his back, and was down on his luck. He was at a casino hoping to win big to support us. This man in a black hat and trench coat came to him. He never saw his face due to it being shrouded in black. This man touched the machine, and Annie and my father won a large sum of money. He told my dad, "There's more where this came from. If you write me a book." My father agreed and asked the man, "What am I writing about?" The man told him, "You'll know," and vanished. Every night he'd wake and write, and the story always came to him in his dreams. Soon after, demonic things started happening. Usually, what happened in the book happened to a friend or family member. I remember him telling me about my aunt. He wrote about two big black dogs with red eyes chasing the main character. The next day, my aunt told him about how there were black dogs with red eyes at the foot of her bed. He never told anyone what he was writing about. He finally found a publisher for his book. She was highly interested until things started happening to her as well. My father had the surgery on his back, and we went to visit him in the hospital. My mom said my sister and I started crying and became hysterical. She asked what was wrong, and we told her about the rat. Well, it was on Daddy's paper. My father was making the cover for his book, which was this demonic-looking rat. After that, he called the publisher and told her to burn the book because he was doing the same. She told him she would gladly burn it. My father told me how he took this book to my grandma's house and burned it in her fireplace. When he did, there was a flame that shot out of the fireplace and over my grandmother's head with a demonic wail. Things calmed down after that. However, we always had spiritual encounters. Sorry it was so long, but I believe my father would have loved to share it with you.
I think this is just a perfect example of somebody that's mentally and physically and emotionally down being a target.
Sure.
And, you know, that's... It's hard to say, hey, keep your spirits up so you don't get haunted. But, yeah. You know, it's just so evident over and over we have stories where people are targets.
Mm-hmm. And don't talk to strangers when playing the slots.
Yeah.
That's the other lesson of the story.
Yeah.
only the waitress when you press the drink button. That's the only person that's safe to talk to. Otherwise, it could be the devil.
Yeah, could be.
You never know. That is creepy. I wondered, was it a requirement there where he would have had to have had the book published and then go back to the casino to get more money? Would it just have shown up? How would that work? What was the end game there? I wonder what was going through his mind.
I thought it was just going to be, I'll have you write this book for me, mm-hmm. and it's going to be wildly successful.
Oh, I get it. That could be.
Could be.
Publishing the devil's manuscript.
Yeah.
Essentially. Interesting. It would be very interesting to hear what was in the book, mm-hmm. other than just, you know, some of the recount there. I wonder how much she knows, our listener here, of what the content was. Although it's probably best not to share.
Yeah.
Considering the source, and not the source being the dad, but the source of wherever he was getting the information from. Thank you for that story. Hello, Tony and Jenny. My name's Rachel from Southern Oregon. I've been listening almost a year now, and I absolutely love the show. You guys are great, scaring the crap out of me and then making me laugh. It's great fun and has even been educational for me. First, a history. Many of the people in my family can see ghosts, are clairvoyant, or are very sensitive or empathic. I consider myself to be sensitive and empathic, so I'm pretty sure this won't be the last time I write in. The story takes place in an old Victorian house in a small city called Dallas, Oregon. The city was established in 1840. The house was on one of the many original Victorian homes in the city and sat downtown in what I call the historical district. The house was once a servant's quarters to a mansion that once sat next to it. A medical clinic now sits where the mansion once was, but the servant's quarters remain. Sometime after the demise of the mansion, a man named Charlie purchased the house and did a lot of adding on to it. He enclosed the wraparound deck to make an office downstairs and extended the upstairs rooms and built a bathroom upstairs. Fun fact, Charlie is one of the resident ghosts, but that's another story for another time. Moving on, I moved into this house with my mom and stepdad when I was 16. I'd been living with my dad in Utah for a while, and my mom was very happy to have her little girl back. My mom had just bought the house, and it had recently been gutted and completely renovated by the real estate agent that had sold the house. Mom excitedly gave me the tour of the house. The front door was right opposite the door to the stairs and opened up into the living room, which had a small office to the left side of the living room, and the living room proceeded to the dining room, then the kitchen, and then the utility laundry room. I ran right up the stairs, excited to see my new room. The upstairs of the house had two bedrooms, a small living roomish space, and a bathroom with an old claw bathtub. My room was the first door on the left at the top of the stairs and had a large window that overlooked the front yard and street. The small living room space separated my room from the second bedroom, which overlooked the backyard. The entire upstairs was like my very own apartment, and I would be spending a lot of time alone in this part of the house, as my mom and stepdad hardly had any use for it. I noticed the first night in this house as I lay on my sleeping bag in the corner of my new room. My bed had not been unpacked yet. I did not feel alone. I stared into my empty, very large room, waiting for something to show itself, but it didn't. I just felt someone there. It didn't feel evil, though, as I was already very familiar with the feeling of evil entities. It was more of a curious feeling. At this time, I had no idea what being empathic or sensitive was, and I always seemed to unconsciously decide that I was just a highly imaginative person. I felt this presence every day. And about 2 months after living there, my mom asked me, "Do you ever feel a presence in the house?" This is not at all a weird question, but the paranormal was a very open subject in our family. Something told me to go with my gut and said, yes, I think there's something here, but it's not bad. For 2 years, everything was peaceful. I always felt like someone was there when I was almost always alone in the house. A lot of weird things happened, but those were mostly attributed to Charlie. But this story is not about him. I've heard you, Tony, and Jenny talk about the possibility that sensitive to paranormal activity picks up when you get pregnant. Well, I did get pregnant when I was 18, and I totally believe that my sensitivity picked up when I was in my senior year in high school and still living at my mom's house. I was an established single mother when I got my CNA license in my first trimester. I was determined to be a great mother and provide for my baby no matter what. So here I was, a pregnant young adult going to school and working full-time 1 to 10 p.m. at the local retirement village as a CNA. Needless to say, I was always tired and would try to relax as much as I could when I could. I guess you could say this was when it all started with her. I was sitting on the couch in the living room in the downstairs part of the house. I was home on a lunch break from school and used that half hour to relax, and I knew I literally lived a 5-minute walk from school. I love spooky, ghostly stuff and was watching A Haunting on the big screen. Then I heard a weird sound coming from the office to the left of me. I couldn't see into the office, but only a little. But the sound kept continuing, and I sat and listened to it. It sounded like someone was getting into a mason jar of pens that I knew were by the computer. I also knew that for a fact that I was home alone. Eventually, I got up and went into the office for a look-see. The sound immediately stopped, but I had that gut feeling that there was someone standing behind the computer chair next to the window. I went back to the couch and kept watching my show when I heard the same sound again. I let it go on for a minute, then checked the office again. This time I wiggled the jar of pens in question around myself just to be sure that this is what I was hearing. It was the exact sound. I went back to my show, but this time it was very slowly turned the TV down and heard the sound again. This time I got up, went to the door of the office and spoke aloud, I can't see you, but I know you are there. I decided not to enjoy the extent of my lunch break at home and walked back to school. Fast forward a month or two, I had what I'll always remember as the most emotionally disturbing dreams ever. In my dream, I was in my room, but it didn't look like my room. It was smaller and the walls were wood planking. It was like I was watching a scene from the furthest corner of the room. And on the other side of the room stood a woman with her back to me. She had light brown hair tied up in a bun and light blue dress with a white tie around apron. She looked like someone from Little House on the Prairie, and standing next to her, closest to my door, was a shorter, old, bald man in a black suit with a black bag. He was a doctor. In the center of the room was a bed and a little girl that laid there. She was very young, no older than 9. She had on a simple yellow-colored nightgown with a floral print. She was a pretty little girl with light brown hair that looked like it had been cut off abruptly at the shoulders. I felt sticky and sweaty when I looked at her, and I kept hearing pneumonia in my head. Her mother and the doctor just stood there staring at her. And this dream really makes me believe I am empathic because I could feel everything. The doctor was defeated, helpless, and almost angry. The mother was about to burst as she felt the helplessness too. She was trying to come to terms with something that was out of her hands. Then they silently left the room. You should know that just writing this makes my eyes well up. It just really bothered me. Then the body did something weird. It was like my consciousness switched to the little girl's body, and then I watched what looked like me sitting up out of the little girl's body, leaving it lifeless behind me. Then I looked over to the left of the bed, and I/she was on, and I saw her sitting next to the bed. She was looking at me with a look that was horror, and I felt it along with a great amount of sorrow and fear. Then she and I made eye contact, and her fear mounted. I thought she would scream, but instead I instantly woke up. I couldn't help but cry a little after this dream. The emotions I felt in it were still in me. I never talked about it, though. I just discounted it for a weird pregnancy dream and too many ghost shows, and put it away in my mind. Fast forward, after I had my son, I moved out of my mom's house and in with my now husband. A close family member of mine, her husband, and two little girls moved into my mom's house and lived there for almost a year. I'll add, this family member can see ghosts and has the ability to pick up details about who they are, like names. During the time that they lived there, a lot went on, but most important to the story, my family member said that sometimes when she would come downstairs, she would see a little girl who she was sure was named Addie in a nightgown with short hair running to my mom's room. I don't know why, but at the time, this description didn't click in my head as a girl from my dream. About a year after my relatives moved out, another relative, let's call him Z, came to visit my mom. Z had no previous knowledge of my mom's house being haunted, wasn't close to my relatives that lived there, and wasn't expecting anything weird to happen. He and my mom came to visit me at my house while he was in town, and he told me about the little ghost girl he had seen during the night. Z said that he was sleeping on the couch in the living room of my mom's house when he suddenly awoke and didn't feel alone. He was facing the backrest of the couch and eventually got up the courage to look over his shoulder behind him. Standing over him, sort of peeking for a better look at Z's face, was a little girl. He said he tried to act like he couldn't see her, I think, as he got a good look at her. The moment they made eye contact, she vanished. He said she was a pretty little girl, about 8 or 9. She was wearing a yellow nightgown with a floral print, and her hair looked like it got hacked off at the shoulders. It all hit me at once, and I was pretty stunned. It was validation that I wasn't just highly imaginative or crazy or whatever. I'd been shown something. Shortly after this, I got a hold of a local paranormal investigation team, and they went to my mom's house for a night and caught plenty of good EVPs. One in particular that sticks out in my memory is when one of the investigators asked a little girl in my mom's room what else she liked. You can hear a little girl say, "Mommy," clear as a bell. My mom and stepdad moved out of that house about 5 years ago, and today it's vacant and it's foreclosed. They said that they heard the little girl's disembodied voice a few times while watching TV downstairs in the living room. It was like, now she knew, they knew, she was there. My mom even started leaving on cartoons during the day while she and my stepdad were at work, and bought an old porcelain doll for her, which would always end up moved like it had been played with. I still sometimes wonder if she is still in that house. It's been years since I lived there. This house still sometimes haunts my dreams. I hope to return to my favorite little town and do some further research on the house, as I think it will help the paranormal based fiction and fantasy novel I'm working on about the other ghostly experiences that I had in that house. I'll tell you about Charlie the next time I write in. Until then, thank you so much for my favorite show and place where I can tell my stories. God bless you and Tony and Jenny and the girls. Thanks again.
I wonder, was that a case of the girl's ghost using her, using the author's body?
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, at first I almost thought, okay, is this a reincarnation thing? Is this a past life thing?
Mm-hmm.
I think more so it was a just being able to use her living energy to show her what happened.
Just to get her story out.
Yeah.
Have her story told for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. Which is odd, because sometimes when you have stories like that, there's like a bigger reason to it. Like, someone murdered me and here's where the body is or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is just simply, you know, it seems a little girl wanting to have her story told.
Yeah.
And you know, what happened to her, albeit, I mean, sad, not a crime.
No.
It was an illness.
Yeah.
That took her. But very odd.
I think the little girl may have felt more comfortable knowing,
mm-hmm.
you know, she probably knew about the pregnancy and felt
sure.
like, okay, this is like a mommy.
Mm-hmm.
So I can, you know, I can gravitate towards her.
Sure. I wonder if it's a case where now that her story has been told and is that she's been able to move on, or if she's still there.
Yeah. I don't know.
Now a lot of people know the story.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I wonder sometimes too. You know, sometimes it's the matter of getting the story told. Is there ever an intention with ghosts that, okay, I'm going to get this story to this person, knowing full well that that person's going to tell this story to others,
mm-hmm.
like to us.
Right.
and then it goes out onto a much larger scale, if that's ever the intent. Because sometimes we get the stories where it seems they know a bit more of the future than we do.
Mm-hmm.
Do they know the path that story will take? And that's why it's being told to that person.
I don't know that.
It's an interesting thing to think about. I don't know. 855-853-4802 is our number. Let's go to Jesse in Wisconsin. Hi.
Hey, it's Jesse from Milwaukee. I'm going to email in a voice memo to you guys instead of calling because I won't have enough time to finish it, my story right now. So I'm going to have to stop in the middle of it and then continue it once I get out of work. But anyway... So here goes. It's not my story. It's a story about my niece when she was a baby. Now she's 7 years old. I mean, she's still a baby, really. But now she's 7 years old. And, when she was 3 years old, she had this imaginary friend. And quite odd, the name of this friend, considering that it's a three-year-old. Her imaginary friend's name was, Chavez. So, yeah, Chavez, like Cesar Chavez. It's not impossible for a child to make up that name. But to be 3 years old and tell people that that's your imaginary friend is kind of, I think it's a little far-fetched in my opinion. But anyway, she would play with Chavez all the time. My brother and his wife would find her in the room talking to someone that they didn't see. And every time they asked who it was, she would reply, "Oh, I'm just playing with Chavez." And, you know, they just thought, you know, nothing other than just imaginary friend. And one day, you know, my brother started getting weird feelings around the house for some reason. So he decided to ask his daughter. He said, he basically asked her if Chavez was a real person or was she imaginary. It's something they never asked her before. And when they asked her, I guess her response was, "No, Chavez is real. Chavez is a little boy, and he plays with me. He comes once in a while, and we play together, and we talk." Okay, I'm back. Anyway, flash forward to a couple years ago. They moved from Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, where we live now. Well, I live in Milwaukee. They live in Oak Creek. So they moved from Fond du Lac to Oak Creek, Wisconsin. And one day, about a couple years ago, she had this toy cell phone. And you know the ones that you hit a button and it makes these weird noises. I don't know. It's just a little Fisher-Price toy cell phone. Anyway, this cell phone's sitting in the room in the clutter, you know, the pile in the room. In the pile of where all the toys are. So, I guess one day this little cell phone, you know, goes off by itself and it does the Fisher-Price ring that it has set up inside of it. And, you know, his daughter runs to the phone and she picks it up like she's talking to someone. And when she hangs up, my brother asks, "Oh, who was that, Delilah, who called?" And he thought it was weird that it rang by itself, but then again, it was amongst other toys in a toy box, so it easily could have been nudged by something in the toy box to go off. But the response that she gave him was quite chilling and shocking, I guess. She told him that, "Oh, that was Chavez. He was calling and he was saying that he's down the block and he's coming to visit." So, you know, my brother was taken aback by that, and he kind of freaked out, I guess. I wasn't there. Like I said, the story was told to me. But sure enough, a few minutes later, Delilah, or his daughter, that's her name, Delilah, she runs to the front door and opens it and then lets, you know, she starts talking and nobody's at the door. But apparently she lets Chavez in and she goes to her room and then she continues playing with nobody. And talking to nobody, and about half an hour passes, and then she comes out of the room, and then my brother, you know, he asks, "What are you doing?" And she goes, "Oh, I'm done. Chavez left. He went back home." And That was it. That was the story. That's it. I think because she was getting a little older and, well, not even, but because she left the house which they lived in so suddenly, I think, in my opinion, you know, Chavez came back one more time to say bye. So that's just a, you know, little story I was told. Well, I was told the second half of the story that, you know, the part where Chavez visited them at their new house. I was told that half a few nights ago, and it, you know, I decided just to call in and let you guys know about it. So, I don't know what to think about that. I mean, it's crazy and definitely shocking, I guess, to me. So, yeah, I guess that answered the question if, you know, if spirits can travel to other places. So, I mean, I guess if you want to call it the proof, there goes your proof. So, again, this is Jesse from Milwaukee. You guys have a good day, night, year, month, week. Talk to you soon. Bye.
Thank you, Jesse, for calling in and sharing your experiences with us. Interesting perspective there on if they can travel, where they can travel, how they can travel. And I guess proof, if you will, that how that works. Although we'll get another call, another story, I'm sure, you know, next show that contradicts it, because that's the fun of the ghost stories. You never really know what the hell's going on. There you go. That wraps up today's episode of Real Ghost Stories Online. If you like the show, please support it. Sign up on the website, realghoststoriesonline.com. Click Become an EPP and help keep us on the air. It's only $5 a month. Get all that bonus material, more than 80-some episodes, exclusive video content, and more. Check it out. Until next time, for Jenny Brusky, I'm Tony Brusky. Thanks for listening to another episode of Real Ghost Stories Online. Hi, it's Tony Brusky from Real Ghost Stories Online. Every single day, Jenny and myself do our best to try and create the best possible show for you. But it's not free to do that. We have a lot of hard costs on this end to distribute the show, produce the show, and put it out there for you. So we ask for your help by becoming an EPP, an extra podcast person. We're doing our best to make it worth your while by giving you a bonus episode every single week with some of the best stories we can find. Also, exclusive video content, including our new monthly video feature, Seeing Ghosts, where we examine some of the best ghost photos and discuss them that we get into the show here at Real Ghost Stories Online. All I ask is that if you listen to the show on a regular basis, please consider helping support keeping it on the air. It's only $5 a month, or sign up for a full year at a time and get 1 month free. If you already are an EPP, thank you very much. If you're not yet, please consider supporting a show that you enjoy so we can continue creating it for you. Sign up at realghoststoriesonline.com. Click Become an EPP. And thank you.
Welcome to Real Ghost Stories Online. Call in your real ghost story now at 855-853-4802 or write in at realghoststoriesonline.com. You are about to enter the world of the unknown and quite possibly the undead. This is Real Ghost Stories Online.
And on today's episode of Real Ghost Stories Online, passersby find they have grown used to seeing an old woman as they go by, only that woman hasn't been there for days. A man boards a bus only to never get off at his stop. A man is compelled to turn the messages he receives at night into a book, only there are some dire consequences to that decision. And could pregnancy have a role and the empathic activity one listener experiences? Those stories, your calls, and more today on Real Ghost Stories Online. Tony and Jenny Brusky joining you once again.
Hello.
Hi, and how are you this fine day?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. I'm glad I'm not visiting Euro Disney or Disney Paris anytime soon, because I don't think you're going to be getting on the haunted house ride anytime. Well, I'll probably get that wrapped up fairly soon. I don't know if you heard. And it's not to make light of it. I just some listeners had sent it to us. And I mean, it's a sad circumstance. An employee there of the park was working in the haunted manor. It's called Phantom Manor at Disneyland Paris. and he was electrocuted when he was working on some part of the ride that needed some fixing, and they found him later. Luckily, he was, from what I understand in the news story, was found by staff, not like children going through the ride going, yeah, my, that looks mighty real. Mm-hmm. But that's that. I don't know if the ride is closed down as of the time of this recording, but I'm sure they'll get that probably up. And it wasn't like it was, I don't believe, super gruesome or,
well,
you know,
that's
destroying
good.
The ride or anything like that.
Yeah.
But it's one of those things where down the road now, it's going to make me wonder if we're going to get stories of a haunted ride. Like we get stories of the haunted ride at Disney World, mm-hmm, of the Pirates of the Caribbean, where there's a story, and it's a true story of a man who was also a maintenance worker there years ago, died while maintaining the ride.
Right, and right now, they say if the staff does not say, you know, good morning to George, or, mm-hmm, you know, thank George for a good day at the end,
sure,
that it causes problems with the ride. And I thought about that when last time we were there,
mm-hmm,
because
it was down all the time.
It was down a lot.
Yeah.
So kind of wondered if somebody sloughed off thanking George. So.
You know, it's an interesting thing. I wonder how often it is where you get the new, you know, employees that come to the park and then the story is told and they're like, yeah, whatever. And they just kind of ignore it. And then it's kind of a learning by experience type deal where, mm-hmm, well, it does break down quite a bit when I don't do it. Maybe I should start trying. And then suddenly it just, you know.
What does it hurt?
Exactly. What does it hurt? So, I don't know. Interesting. It makes me also wonder about, would this be a news story if it had happened on a different ride other than the Haunted Mansion? You know, being what it is, and it being, you know, it makes me wonder how often do things like this happen at parks like that,
mm-hmm,
you know, because there's so many moving parts, for lack of a better term.
Sure.
And a lot of electricity and a lot of this and a lot of that. How often, you know, are there tragedies that are kind of, you know, swept under the rug and, mm-hmm, not like they pretend they don't happen. They just kind of keep them quiet and take care of the families and, you know,
right,
and try not to make a big deal out of it,
mm-hmm,
for lack, you know, not wanting to have a big news story. But anyway, when I first saw the story, I had to like look it up a couple places to make sure it wasn't some sort of bizarro, not real news,
sure,
story, because we get those sometimes. But no, it's, I've looked at several places and it appears to be legit. So not a good situation. So there you go. Interesting, mm-hmm, stuff. We'll see in 5 years if we start getting ghost stories from that park. I was also curious about the ride.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, how much is it like the other ones? Fairly similar.
Is it like Disneyland's Haunted Mansion or Disney World's?
Never
Haunted
been to the Disneyland one, but it seems to have a lot of aspects of the Disney World one.
What does it look like on the outside?
It looks more like, that's why we ask for your support in keeping it on the air by becoming an EPP. It's only $5 a month. You sign up to be one on our website, realghoststoriesonline.com. Click become an EPP. We try and make it as affordable as possible. $5 a month. It keeps all the free episodes going, gets you the bonus episodes every single week, and all the bonus video content as well, and all the other extras that we give our EPPs. I just the other day updated the EPP site with some of the back episodes, because iTunes only goes so far.
Sure.
As far as how many episodes they show. And it's not us, like, restricting how many episodes. Some shows do that. Some shows are like, you only get 10 episodes and the rest. No, we leave them all up there as long as iTunes will leave them there.
Mm-hmm.
But, and it's really a numbers thing. I believe it goes to, like, $2.99 or something.
We just have too many episodes.
There's just too many damn episodes.
Yeah.
So, in order to still enjoy those fine episodes, like about Amityville Horror and Conjuring and many others, the true stories behind them, the EPPs get those as well. So the ones that drop off, I put onto the EPP site so you can enjoy them mm-hmm. there too. So really, I mean, there's the 80-some EPP episodes that are up there, but there's got to be damn near 100 other episodes too of the older regular episodes that are now up there. So there's a lot.
Yeah.
It's a lot of listening. If you will, for only $5 a month. So check that out. Junior writes in, good evening, Mr. and Mrs. Brewski. I recently listened to an episode of yours where Mr. Brewski, I never get called that, was asking for stories about haunted vehicles. Hearing that triggered a stored memory of mine about a haunted city bus. This incident occurred in 2012 in Southern California. I was a late night driver through a bad part of town and had just finished dropping off the last passenger, or so I thought. I'm pretty meticulous about paying attention as how many people aboard the bus, but something felt off. I didn't feel alone. All of a sudden, a shiver ran through my body and all my hairs stood on end. At first, I didn't think much of it, just figured a window was left open and a gust of cold wind swept through the bus. But it was summertime in Southern California. I checked my passenger mirror directly above the driver to check on the passengers, and not a soul in sight. There's a big black box behind the driver that holds all the vehicle's computer systems, and it prevents me to look over my shoulder and check. I then proceeded to look to my right. All night, all the windows act as a mirror inside the bus, eliminating blind spots. And that's when I saw him. An older gentleman sitting directly behind me in the black box. I found it strange that I'd failed to see him before. Just figured I'd made a mistake on my count, that's all. I tried making small talk about the weather or sports, but I got no response. I then asked him for at least a destination so I wouldn't pass his bus stop. But still, there was no response. He sat motionless, just looking out the window, not even acknowledging me. At that point, no response. My mom is well known for not taking anyone's crap and won't stand for someone she's friends with to ignore her and refuse a greeting. She walked over to her and got about 2 feet from the old lady's face to make sure the lady saw her. As she leaned in, she expected to see the woman's features clearly, but she didn't. She was completely black and featureless. At this point, my mom felt a little apprehensive but unsure of what she was seeing, so she walked away and came home. I should say she was not alone. A cousin of hers that she had never met until that day was with her, and she saw what happened and said to her, "Ignore her if she's going to be that way." And he went home as well. The next day, my mom saw the old lady in the morning and went to her and said, "Didn't you hear me saying goodnight to you last night?" The old lady was confused. She said, "I haven't seen you in a couple days." My mom said she felt her blood pressure drop a little and found her cousin later that day still visiting. She told him what happened, and right away he said, "Oh shit, it was a ghost." She shrugged it off, refusing to believe it, but he insisted on investigating. Throughout the day, they went around asking people if anyone had ever heard of an old lady appearing there at the tree at night, and most folks will tell you, yes, she's there sometimes when it's dark and the moon is the only light outside. Waiting, facing the street, I have many more stories. From family and from myself especially. I've been practicing magic, not exactly witchcraft. It's a bit more formal, and specifically I work with demons and deities. I started these practices after I arrived in Mexico, and as a direct consequence of my friend's murder. More on this another day. Anonymous from Texas.
I think it's funny that the person who heard the story believed it was a ghost before she actually did, the one that experienced it.
Well, when you go over there and you look at the person and they have no features, it's just this dark hole. Isn't that sign number one that there may be a ghost going on here or something not so normal?
So they just essentially saw a shadow person and she just assumed it was the same lady that's usually in that spot. Okay.
I think.
That's kind of what I got from it.
I couldn't tell if it was a shadow person or if it was like a fully clothed person and there was like just no features there. I think that would be more of the dead giveaway. Maybe it was more like you're describing.
Okay.
And that's why I'm kind of confused. Like, how the hell did you not know what you were, you know, looking at? Maybe it is more of that nature where from a distance it looks like there's a person there and you get there and it's just kind of this dark thing. I think that makes more sense.
Yeah.
More logical sense as to why the person would be confused and leave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, there you go.
There you go.
Not so crazy after all. There you go. 855-853-4802 is our phone number at Real Ghost Stories Online. And as we always say, if you like this show, unfortunately, it does not run on good vibes. As much as good vibes would run the show, it costs money. The Disneyland one.
Okay.
On the outside. But the interior seems a lot fairly similar to the world.
Mm-hmm.
So is the land the same as the world as far as how the ride goes?
They're very, very similar.
Not identical, but similar?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's just the outside looks totally different.
Yeah. Okay. I was just wondering how much they duplicated from park to park. Anyhow. 855-853-4802 is our phone number here at Real Ghost Stories Online to share your real ghost stories with us. Of course, you can also write it on our website, realghoststoriesonline.com, or if you'd like to record your story on your mobile device. I like that one better.
Mobile device.
You can do that, and you can email us that audio then. Tony at realghoststoriesonline.com is the place to send that audio from your mobile devices. Our first story, dear Tony and Jenny, I have many stories to tell, but this is a short one for you, and I hope you'll enjoy. In the year 2003, after my best friend was murdered, my sister, my mother, and I decided to leave California. We were tired of the gang violence that had taken my best friend from me, and this event changed us. I believe it opened my third eye as I was there when he was murdered, and so I came close to death that night. We decided to move to Mexico as there was an old abandoned family home, and we wanted to go there temporarily until we got over the shock and depression. We ended up staying there for 8 years, and I married a local woman, and we now have a beautiful 6-year-old girl who is very naturally gifted. More on that some other day. I believe my mother has always been sensitive, but after we moved to Mexico, we all became so sensitive that it caused us a bit of trouble sometimes. One night, my mom was heading home from our sister's house, which was a short 3-minute walk from the house, and we were staying in, and as she got close to the house, she saw a little old lady sitting next to a rubber tree that is outside on the corner of the street of our house. This is a tree that is close to 100 years old. An uncle of mine planted it when he was a young man, and he was about 90 when he passed away about 10 years ago. Anyway, my mother knew a lady that lived down our street, a very skinny old lady that resembles the classic witch, and many people say that she is in fact a witch and does ritual work at night. She's a sweet old lady and related to us distantly that she lives with her son who is in his 50s. He's a trucker, and this is a dangerous job in Mexico due to the drug dealers frequently robbing large trucks either for their contents or simply to instill fear in the locals and flex their authority. The lady sits at the rubber tree most nights to wait for her son to arrive and to be sure he's safe. This night, when my mom saw her, she didn't think anything of it and said, "Buenas noches," as is a custom and polite thing to say as you pass by someone in a small town or village. She didn't receive a response. The lady just sat there in the darkness next to the rubber tree. My mom repeated louder this time, "Buenas noches," and still.